الحمد لله رب العالمين، له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين، أما بعد. سورة الغاشية. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هل أتاك حديث الغاشية؟ وجوه يومئذ خاشعة، عاملة ناصبة، تصلى نارا حامية، تسقى من عين آنية، ليس لهم طعام إلا من ضريع، لا يسمن ولا يغني من جوع، وجوه يومئذ ناعمة، لسعيها راضية، في جنة عالية، لا تسمع فيها لاغية، فيها عين جارية، فيها سرر مرفوعة، وأكواب موضوعة، ونمارق مصفوفة، وزرابي مبثوثة، أفلا ينظرون إلى الإبل كيف خلقت، وإلى السماء كيف رفعت، وإلى الجبال كيف نصبت، وإلى الأرض كيف سطحت، فذكر إنما أنت مذكر، لست عليهم بمسيطر، إلا من تولى وكفر، فيعذبه الله العذاب الأكبر، إن إلينا إيابهم، ثم إن علينا حسابهم. سورة الغاشية is a surah makkiyah باتفاق المفسرين. The scholars of tafsir unanimously agree, all of them, that Surah Al-Ghashiyah is a Meccan surah. What does a Meccan surah mean? It means it came down before the Hijrah to Medina. So Meccan means what? قبل الهجرة, before the Hijrah. This is when Surah Al-Ghashiyah came down. And the word Al-Ghashiyah, it means overwhelming. What does Al-Ghashiyah mean? It means the overwhelming. Surah Al-Ghashiyah, it's from the suwar. It's from the suwars which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to lead in Salatul Eid and in Salatul Jum'ah. Salatul Eid and in Salatul Jum'ah, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would read this surah. Surah Al-Ghashiyah. And I want you to all take this, inshallah ta'ala, which is, there are names, there are four things, two which are not created, and two which are created. And they are what the name means, meaning they represent the name. Two are not created, and two were created. The first one is Allah Azza wa Jalla. Allah has many names, and each of those names, they have characteristics, and Allah is those characteristics. Are we all together, brothers? Allah Azza wa Jalla, he has the name Allah. Allah means what? Ay al-ma'luh, the one that's worshipped. Ay al-ma'bud, that's the meaning that's in it. Ar-Rahman, what is in it? Ar-Rahma. Al-Aziz, what's in it? Al-Ghalibu fi amrihi. Aziz means the one who, when he wants something, it will happen the way he wants it. No one can stop it. Ar-Rahman, what does it mean? The one who has mercy. Even all of the names of Allah, there are characteristics in it, and Allah is those characteristics. Are we all together, brothers? The second is, which is not created, is the Quran. The Quran has many names. From the names that it has is Al-Furqan. What does Al-Furqan mean? أَن يُفَرِّقُ بَيْنَ الْحَقِّ وَالْبَاطِلِ. The Quran distinguishes the truth from the falsehood. What does it do? It distinguishes the truth from the... As Allah said, وَكَذَلِكَ نُفَصِّلُ الْآيَاتِ وَلِتَسْتَبِينَ سَبِيلُ الْمُجْرِمِينَ. The Quran, it clarifies. It explains things. It makes the path of the wrongdoers clear from the path of the righteous ones. Are we all together? The third is Nabiullah Muhammad. His name is Muhammad. And Muhammad means what? The one that's praised a lot. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he is praised. And his name also is Ahmed. The one who praises Allah a lot. Muhammad is the one who's praised a lot. And Ahmed is what? The one who is praising Allah a lot. Humans don't always represent their names. You may find a person whose name is called Abdullah, and he's a disbeliever. He's not a true slave to Allah. So he doesn't represent his name. Whereas Nabiullah Muhammad, what does he do? He is what his name is. And the third one is the Day of Judgment. The Day of Judgment has many names. From its name is Qiyamah, which is يَوْمَ يَقُومُ النَّاسُ لِرَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The day where the people are going to stand in front of Allah. Qiyamah means what? The standing in front of Allah. From its name is Akhirah, meaning it's the last. From its name is التغابن. What does تغابن mean? تغابن means when you've exchanged that which is high and great with that which is low. Everybody has a place in Jannah, and everybody has a place in hellfire. If you end up going to the hellfire, you've taken the place in the hellfire over the place in... That's why it's called تغابن. All of those four which I mentioned, they represent their names. Are we all together? And the scholars, they say this is أعلام باعتبار دلالتها على الذات وأوصاف باعتبار دلالتها على المعاني. That is what summarizes what I just mentioned. Those names have characteristics in it, and each and every one of those characteristics, those four which I mentioned, they are those characteristics. So the Day of Judgment, from one of its names is Al-Ghashiyah, the overwhelming one. What does it do? It overwhelms. The scholars, they differed on what is meant by Al-Ghashiyah. There's two views. There are what? Two views. Some of the scholars, they said Al-Ghashiyah, it means the overwhelming, but it's referring to the Day of Judgment. That's one view. The first view is that the Al-Ghashiyah is ismun min asma'i yawm al-qiyamah. It's a name from the names of the Day of Judgment. And this is the view of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhumah. It's also the view of Qatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi, the student of Ibn Abbas. There's another view, which is Al-Ghashiyah here is talking about the hellfire. It's the nar. It's referring to the what? To the nar. And it's not referring to the Qiyamah. Those are the two views. So it's overwhelming, meaning the Day of Judgment is going to overwhelm the person. And the second view is, no, it's the hellfire that's going to overwhelm the people. And the evidence which they used to say that it's referring to the hellfire is that Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, he said about the hellfire, وَتَغْشَى وُجُوهَهُمُ النَّارِ وَتَغْشَى غَاشِيَةً. An-Nara is the hellfire. In Surah Ibrahim, Allah said that. And Allah said in Surah Al-A'raf, لَهُمْ مِنْ جَهَنَّمَ مِهَادٍ وَمِنْ فَوْقِهِمْ Ghawash. Ghawash is ghashia. So they said this is the hellfire. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. So first of all, what's the sabab al-khilaf? Why have they differed into these two views? Are you with me, brothers? Why did these two views come? The two views came because al-ghashia is an adjective. Al-ghashia is a wasf. Al-ghashia is a what? It's a wasf, it's a description. The reason why the khilaf came is, what is the mawsuf, the thing that's been described? It's a wasf, it's a description. For what lacking? Are we all together, brothers? And both of them, Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said, it's both. What did he say? Both views are correct. He said, because, he said, وَكِلْتَاهُمَا غَاشِيَةً. Both of them are ghashiyah. The Day of Judgment, and also what? The Hellfire, he said, both of them are ghashiyah. هذه تغشى الناس بالبلاء والأهوال والكروب وهذه تغشى الكفار باللفح في الوجوه والشواظ والنحاس فلا قول أصح من أن يقال كما قال جل ثناؤه ويعم الخبر بذلك كما عمه. Allah left it unrestricted. Allah, He hid the thing that was being described. He just said, هل أتاك حديثه الغاشية, the overwhelming. And Allah didn't choose to mention what was the thing that was overwhelming. And the reason why Allah left it unrestricted and didn't mention it, so both of them can come under it. Ibn Jarir said. Are you with me, brothers? And that's a better view. Because to reconcile between the views takes precedence than choosing one over the other. Because Sahib al-Maraqi, what did he say? وَالْجَمْعُ وَاجِبٌ مَتَى مَا أَمْكَنَا. It's necessary to bring the two views together as if you're able to do so. Does that make sense, brothers? So this is Surah Al-Ghashiyah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, هَلْ أَتَاكَ, has they reached you? هَلْ أَتَاكَ, has they reached you? حَدِيثُ الْغَاشِيَةِ, the report of the overwhelming event, has it reached you, Muhammad, or has it reached you, mankind? This is the two views again. Hal ataka, has it reached you? Who's the one that's being referred to here? The scholars of the Mufassirin, they took two views. The first is Muhammad is being spoken to here. He's the mukhatab. The one that's being addressed here is who? The messenger. Hal ataka Muhammad, has it reached you? That's one. And another group, they said, umumun nas, it's all of the people. Oh mankind, has it not reached you? And both of them is easy to be reconciled. Because even though the Quran is talking to the Prophet, it's not restricted to him. Because the qa'ida is al-ibrata bi'umumi al-lafzi la bi khususi sabab. And as the Arabs say, iyyaka a'ni wasma' ya jara. When Allah said to the Prophet, ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu taqillah, O Prophet of Allah, have taqwa, was it restricted to him? Was it restricted to him? Was he the only one that was being told to come with taqwa? Or was everybody being told to come with taqwa? Everybody was being told to come with taqwa. So even though Allah said, ya ayyuha an-nabiyyu taqillah, it's not only him that's being spoken to here. Who's also being spoken to as well? All of us. All of us need to come with taqwa. So, hal ataka, has it come to you, Muhammad, and all of you, mankind? Has it reached you, the report of the overwhelming event? The scholars, they said, hal ataka, is it a question? Or is it a statement? Hal ataka here, is it istifham? Is the Prophet being questioned? Is Allah saying, has it reached you? Is that what he's trying to say? Is it istifham or is it not? There are views. The views that have come are the following. One, the first view is Some scholars who said, wherever in the Quran you see hal ataka, wherever you see in the Quran hal ataka, it means qad ataka. Some of the scholars are of that opinion. Wherever you see hal ataka, what does it mean? It means qad ataka, it has verily come to you. It's not a question. It's rather saying, Muhammad and every one of you, mankind, it has verily reached you. Certainty. Indeed, it has reached you, the event of the overwhelming. Are we all together? That's the first view. That the word hal here means qad. Qad ataka. It has come to you. And these scholars, they said, this is a principle. Whenever you read the Quran, and you open the Quran, and you come across hal ataka, what does it mean? Qad ataka, they said. It's a qa'ida muttarida. It's a general ruling through the Quran, they said. The second view is, no, it's a question. But the question here is not waiting for a response from the Prophet or us. It's actually asking to get the attention of the people. It's like when you say to somebody, did I not warn you? Are you with me, brothers? Did I not tell you that this will happen? The question here is not that you want an answer. It's saying to the person what? To get their attention. So they feel it more. It's what? It's not. And the third one is, it's a question. It's actually a istifham, and the question, the answer is being waited. It is being waited from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, hal ataka, has it reached you, Muhammad? Hadithul ghashiyah, the event, the report of the overwhelming event. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He tells us in the verse after this overwhelming event, how it's going to be. This ghashiyah, this overwhelming, the people are how many parties? There are two parties. Allah is going to mention the first party of people, which are the criminals and the disbelievers and the wrongdoers. And the second, Allah is going to talk about what? The pious and the righteous. And that's how the Quran is. So al-ghashiyah here, it's overwhelming for two parties. The first party is the criminal, and the way that it's overwhelming for them, we will speak about. And it's also overwhelming for the believers and the righteous people, and we will see how it's overwhelming for them. Are you with me, brothers? Allah talks about it like that. And in the Quran, when you look at it, Allah always talks about the criminals and the wrongdoers. And then He talks about the what? Righteous. The reason is because to balance between fear and hope. As Allah said in the Quran, نَبِّ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. Tell my slaves, نَبِّ عِبَادِي أَنِّي أَنَا الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Tell them that I'm very merciful. So you have hope. And also tell them what? وَأَنَّ عَذَابِي هُوَ الْعَذَابُ الْأَلِيمُ. And also inform them that my punishment is severe. Allah also said, غَافِرِ ذَنْبِي وَقَابِلِ التَّوِي شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. Allah is what? غَافِرُ الذَّنْبِ. He forgives the sins. He forgives, He accepts the tawbah. He also what? He's شَدِيدُ الْعِقَابِ. And He's severe in His punishment. And then, the bird, what does it need? It needs two wings in order to fly. It cannot fly with one wing. The believer, in order to fly to Jannah, and to get to Allah Azza wa Jalla, he needs the two wings of hope and fear to be balanced. So the Quran will do that. The people who, the first party are the criminals. And the criminals are two types that Allah is going to speak about. The first one are the kuffar and the disbelievers. The ones who have not believed in Allah. The ones who have not, they have not believed in Allah. And the second one is what? Usatil mu'mineen. The sinners from amongst the believers. They are also from the first party. Rusatul Mu'mineen. Because the qa'idah is كل آية وردت في الكفار فإنه يجر بذيلها عصاة المؤمنين. That's a qa'idah. Every verse that came down on the disbelievers, that verse's tail, the tail of that verse, it's dragging the sinners of the believers. It's also in there. And we'll show examples, inshallah ta'ala, of that. Are we all together, brothers? And the second are the righteous slaves of Allah that will be spoken about, inshallah ta'ala. So let's start with the first group, which are the ones who are the disbelievers and the believers who are criminals. Allah says, وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ خَاشِعَةٌ. Some faces that day will be humbled. وُجُوهٌ. Some faces يَوْمَئِذٍ, that day, meaning the day of judgment. خَاشِعَةٌ. Those faces are going to be what? They're going to become humbled that day. This is the face of who? It's the faces of the disbelievers. Their faces that day is what's going to happen to them. Their faces are going to be, they're going to be humiliated that day. They're going to be put down that day. And so are the usat al-mu'mineen, the believers who disobeyed Allah. They also fall under that as well. How? Allah said in the Quran, يَوْمَ تَبْيَضُّ وُجُوهُ وَتَسْوَدُّ وُجُوهُ. The day when the faces glow, and some faces are going to be darkened. Some faces are going to what? In Surah Al-Imran, what did Allah say? يَوْمَ تَبْيَضُّ وُجُوهُ. The day of judgment, some faces are going to glow, and another group of faces are going to be what? Darken. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, the faces of Ahlul Sunnah is going to glow, and the faces of the innovators is going to be darkened that day. Are we all together, brothers? وُجُوهٌ يَوْمَئِذٍ خَاشِعَةٌ. And it's also talking about the disbelievers. The word خَاشِعَةٌ, it means ذَلِيلَةٌ, humiliated. They're going to be humiliated that day. And that's the tafsir of Qatada ibn Da'amah al-Sadusi rahimahullah, the student of who? The student of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhuma. Amilatun nasiba, Allah says. Amila means working. Working what? Amilatun, working very hard. Nasibatun means exhausted. They're working hard, but they're exhausted. Here the question is, this working, so remember, amilatun goes back to the faces. Wujuhun, those faces, the faces here is a representation of themselves. Sah? The face doesn't necessarily mean just a face. What does it mean, brothers? You in totality. When we say kullu man alayha fan, everything is going to perish. وَيَبْقَى وَجْهُ رَبِّكَ, your Lord's face is going to remain. Does it mean only Allah's face is going to remain, everything else is going to perish? No. It means Allah is going to remain. For example, we say, I gave this person this because of your face. The Arabs, they say that. Meaning because of you, I gave it to them. Are you with me? It doesn't mean just because of your face I gave it to them, not because of your hands. Sah? Pay attention to this. So these people are going to be what? Amilatun, they are working. And Allah says, nasibatun, and they are exhausted, tired, fatigue. Are you with me, brothers? What does that mean? They're working hard and they are exhausted. And where is this working taking place? The Mufassireen, the scholars of tafsir, have two opinions. The first opinion is, they're going to be working hard the day of judgment. In the day of judgment, they're going to be working hard and they're going to get exhausted. How are they going to work hard and how are they going to be exhausted? They said, the disbelievers, when they come to the hellfire, they are going to be carrying the chains in Jahannam. As Allah said, سَأُرْهِقُهُ سَعُودًا. They're going to be told, climb, climb the levels of the hellfire. They're going to be told, carry the chains. So they're working and they're exhausted, they're tired. Are you with me, brothers? This goes back to a mas'ala, an issue, which some people say, which is, this dunya is darul amal. This world is the world of action, and the day of judgment is not actions. Some people say that, right? Huh? You hear that, right? This ayah nullifies it. There are actions the day of judgment. From the actions the day of judgment is, يَوْمَ يُكْشَفُ عَنْ سَاقٍ وَيُدْعَوْنَ إِلَى السُّجُودِ. People are going to prostrate the day of judgment. Nabi Muhammad, is he not going to prostrate to Allah the day of judgment to ask for the intercession? So is the day of judgment actions as well? Huh? It is. It's also accountability lacking. Are you with me, brothers? So some of the scholars, they said, عَامِلَةٌ نَاصِبًا means they're going to work hard in the hellfire. And that day, they're going to work and they're going to be exhausted from it. They're going to be carrying chains and they're going to be told to work. As Allah said, وَمَنْ يُعْرَضُ. The one who is turned from عَنْ ذِكْرِ رَبِّهِ, from the remembrance of his Lord. Allah says, يَسْلُكُ عَذَابًا صَعَدًا. In the hellfire, he's going to be told to walk and move. Are you with me, brothers? They're also going to work hard by making dua, but they're just going to get tired. No one's going to take it into consideration. As Allah said, لَا تَدْعُوا الْيَوْمَ ثُبُورًا وَاحِدًا وَادْعُوا ثُبُورًا كَثِيرًا. They ask for destruction for themselves. They ask for destruction. Oh, my destruction. When they see the punishment that's waiting for them. Allah says, don't ask for it once, but ask for it a lot if you want. So they're working, but they get exhausted from it. Also, the working that they're going to be doing is, they're going to be arguing with one another. They're going to be what? They're going to be arguing with one another. Allah said in the ayah, وَإِذْ يَتَحَاجُونَ فِي النَّارِ. When they are arguing and disputing with one another, فِي النَّارِ, in the fire. فَيَقُولُ الضُّعَفَاءِ, the weak ones are going to say, لِلَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا, to the arrogant one, إِنَّا كُنَّا لَكُمْ تَبَعًا. We used to be your followers. Rappers, football players, we used to see you as role models. We worshipped you, we stuck your pictures on the wall. We took you as role models. You became everything for us. إِنَّا كُنَّا لَكُمْ تَبَعًا فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ تُغْنُونَ. Are you today going to save us and protect us? مُغْنُونَ عَنَّا نَصِيبًا مِنَ النَّارِ. Can you take us away from the hellfire? We bought all your albums. We bought all your musics. We memorized it. We wrote your names on our t-shirts. We knew your biography, where you were born. We knew how many children you had. We gave our life and our energy to you. فَهَلْ أَنْتُمْ مُغْنُونَ. Can you save us today from the hellfire? And then they say to them, قَالَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَكْبَرُوا. The arrogant ones, meaning the ones that were followed, are going to look at the weak ones, who were the followers, and they will say to them, إِنَّا كُلٌّ فِيهَا. All of us are in this together. All of us are in this together. We can't help you as much as you can't help us. إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ حَكَمَ بَيْنَ الْعِبَادِ. And Allah has chosen to judge between His slaves. There's nothing we can really do for you. Are you with me, brothers? So look at this argument that's taking place. Also, they start to curse each other. As Allah said, كُلَّمَا دَخَلَتْ أُمَّةٌ لَعَنَتْ أُخْتَهَا. Whenever the hellfire, another group start entering, because it becomes tight on them, they start cursing the ones that are coming in. So they work, but they get exhausted from all of this. They get what? Exhausted from it. Some of the scholars, they said, no. We are of the opinion that the day of judgment is not a day of actions. The actions are restricted to what? The dunya. It's referring to the Christians and the Jews who are worshipping their so-called religion and they're getting tired from it. The day of judgment, there's nothing for them. It's just exhausting. In this dunya, They're working. You see the rabbi, you see the monk crying, and Jesus this and Jesus that. But really, nothing is going to come from it. As Allah said, وَقَدِمْنَا إِلَى مَا عَمِلُوا مِنْ عَمَلٍ فَجَعَلْنَاهُ هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا. We're going to bring forward everything which they did, and we're going to make it هَبَاءً مَنْثُورًا, like it never existed. In another ayah, Allah says, قُلْ هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَهُمْ يَحْسَبُونَ أَنَّهُمْ يُحْسِنُونَ سُنْعًا. They were doing hard. They thought what they were doing was right. They believed in this. They genuinely believed this was what God wanted from them. They actually believed that they were on the right path. Allah says in that verse, قُلْ مُحَمَّدْ, say to them, هَلْ نُنَبِّئُكُمْ, shall we tell you, بِالْأَخْسَرِينَ أَعْمَالًا, those who are destroyed, who really don't have no actions, but they think they have actions. What are they? الَّذِينَ ضَلَّ سَعْيُهُمْ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا. They spent all of their life doing this particular thing, but really not, it wasn't accepted. When they come there, وَبَدَى لَهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يَكُونُوا يَحْتَسِبُونَ. It became clear to them when they came to Allah, that which they were not thinking. Oh, I thought I was going to enter Jannah. What happened? From the people who are going to be in there, is those who innovated. The Prophet ﷺ, he said in the hadith, in Sahihain Bukhari Muslim, in hadith Aisha, مَنْ عَمِلَ عَمَلًا لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمُرُنَا فَوَرَدْ. And the riwayah of Muslim is what? مَنْ أَحْدَثَ فِي أَمْرِنَا هَذَا مَا لَيْسَ مِنْهُ فَوَى فَوَرَدْ. The actions that they were doing, the innovators, and they were adding to the religion, and they were placing in the deen of Allah Azza wa Jalla, what's going to happen? They believed that this is right. They believed this is what Allah wanted for them to do. Allah says, the day of judgment when they come, it gets rejected in their face. Because this is not what Allah sanctioned. This is not what Allah legislated. The road to Allah is blocked. All of the roads are blocked. الطرق كلها مسدودة إلا طريق من اقتفى أثر محمد. All of the roads to Allah is blocked, except the road that Nabiullah Muhammad took. There's no road to Allah except one road, and that is the road Nabiullah Muhammad took. Just be behind him. Are you with me, brothers? ولذلك, the scholars, they said, every action that you want to do, ask yourself two questions. The first one is, لمن, who are you doing it for? وكيف, and how are you going to do it? Those are two questions. Who are you doing this action for? Which is the answer of it, it has to be Allah, sincerity. And how are you going to do it? In accordance to the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. ولذلك, some of those people will be brought the day of judgment, as the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. He said, Yudadu. The Prophet ﷺ, he said, a group of people will be shooed away from my hold, my fountain, the day of judgment. The same way that the sheep, when it goes into a herd, or it goes into a land that isn't its land, the owner, what does he do? What does he do to the sheep? Go, shoo, 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 it's not your land, it's not your grass, don't eat from it. Some people, they would be pushed away from my fountain like that. And then he said, I will then say, my ummah, my people. And then it will be said to me, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي مَا حَدَثُ بَعْدَكَ. Muhammad, you don't know what they did after you, what they introduced. Look what the Prophet said, إِنَّكَ لَا تَدْرِي, Muhammad, you don't know, مَا أَحْدَثُ, that which they added to your religion. They made things up. They said, this is the religion of Allah. They changed it, they altered it. So they're going to be told, you're not going to drink from this fountain. You don't have no rights to drink from this fountain. Go away. And then look what the Prophet said. When I get told this, I say, suhqan, suhqa. Distance them from me. Ah. If they've changed my religion, and they've added things to it, then of course, distance them from me. And then, brothers, it's not about how much actions that you do. It's not quantity, it's quality. That's what Allah said in the ayah, لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ. Did Allah say, أَكْثَرُكُمْ عَمَلًا? Did He say the one that does the most actions? Is that what Allah said? What did He say? The one who does the best of actions, not the one who does most actions. Are you with me, brothers? It's about the best. So don't be one who's amilatun nasiba, a person who's what? Who's working hard, but he gets exhausted and really there is no substance to what he's doing. There's no value to it. Be careful, brothers. Be careful. Amilatun nasiba, working hard and exhausting the action which they are doing. Walidhalika, brothers, a believer, while we're at this verse, a believer, brothers, whilst he's in this world, the terminology and the term holiday doesn't exist in his dictionary. This term holiday is not in the dictionary of the believer. If you look at the Quran, what did Allah say to the Prophet? Allah said to the Prophet ﷺ, in the Quran Allah says, فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ فَانْصَبْ. What does it mean? فَإِذَا فَرَغْتَ. If you finish one ibadah and you've done it, what did Allah say? Did He say, take a holiday? You've done a good job. فَانْصَبْ means go to another ibadah. Go back to another ibadah. Consistent, carry on. You have no holiday. As long as you live, working, exerting your effort, putting hard work in. This is important, brothers, is to work hard. And the day of judgment, the thing that takes the people to Jannah after Allah's mercy is what? Udkhulul jannata bima kuntum ta'amaloon. Enter Jannah because of what? Because of the actions that you came with. After Allah's mercy and His kindness and His generosity, your actions are what's going to take you to Jannah. Your actions. And the Prophet ﷺ, he said, what did he say? He said, يَتَّبِعُ الْمَيِّتَ ثَلَاثَ. How many things follow the dead? Three. فَيَرْجِعُ اثنان وَيَبْقَى. Two come back and what remains with you? In the grave. Three things go with you. Two come back from the grave. And one stays with you inside the grave. What is the one that stays with you in the grave? Your deeds. Your actions. Are you with me, brothers? And the actions, brothers, it stands on doing what you're told to do and staying away from that which you were told to stay away from. That's all Islam is. You're a slave. The master tells you, do this. You say, Sami'na wa ata'na. I hear and I obey. And the master tells you, stay away from this. Don't get close to it, don't do it. You say, I hear and I obey. That's a slave. Are you with me, brothers? Amilatun nasiba, working hard and exhausting. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says, tasla naran hamia. They will enter into, tasla naran. They will enter into, Allah says, naran, a burn in, ama, a hot fire, naran hamia. They will enter into a burning hot fire. These people, the punishment that's going to be for them, the day of judgment, it is what? Fire. Allah Azza wa Jalla is going to take them to what? He's going to enter them into a burning fire. The fire, the people who are going to enter it are two types. Number one are the disbelievers. And the disbelievers will stay in the hellfire for what? Forever. And they will never come out of it. Are you with me, brothers? The believers like him, if they do enter the hellfire, however much crimes he has committed, and however much wrong he has come with, a believer does not stay in the hellfire forever. A believer will never stay in the hellfire for what? Forever. But who would want to stay in the hellfire even for a split second? Even for what? Split second. And not knowing how long it can be that you're going to stay in the hellfire. And whenever your skin burns, Allah says, كُلَّمَا نَضِجَتْ جُلُودُهُمْ بَدَّلْنَاهُمْ جُلُودًا غَيْرَهَا لِيَذُوقُوا الْعَذَابِ. Every time your skin peels with the fire and it burns, Allah says, we give them a new set of skin so they taste the punishment of the hellfire. This is something your mind cannot take, brothers. The hellfire, brothers, it has 70,000 ropes. The Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith, لَهَا سَبْعُونَ أَلْفَ زِمَامٍ, 70,000 ropes. لِكُلِّ زِمَامٍ, each rope, سَبْعُونَ أَلْفَ مَلَكٍ يَجُرُّونَهَا, 70,000 angels are holding it down. How many ropes? How many ropes? 70,000 ropes are dangling from the hellfire. Each rope, how many angels are holding it down? 70,000 angels are holding it down. يَجُرُّونَهَا, they want to keep it down. Allah says, إِذَا رَأَتْهُمْ مِن مَكَانٍ بَعِيدٍ سَمِعُوا لَهَا تَغَيُّضًا وَزَفِيرًا. The hellfire knows its people. It knows its people very well. Allah says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, إِذَا رَأَتْهُمْ, when the hellfire sees its people and those who should be entering into it and those who should be in it, Allah says, it makes a roaring noise. It screams and it shouts. And those angels, what do they have to do? They have to pin it down. And they have to hold it down. Brothers, everything is put in. Those who need to be in the hellfire, Allah puts them in the hellfire. It's full. There's nothing else to put in it. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He says to the hellfire, هَلْ امْتَلَأْتَ, are you full? And the hellfire says, هَلْ مِنْ مَزِيدٍ, you have more for me, I'll take it. And the narration mentioned, حَتَّى يَضَعُ الرَّبُّ, Allah then takes his leg and he puts it into the fire. And then the hellfire says, قَطٌ قَطٌ, as the narration mentioned, it swallows itself. Are you with me, brothers? This fire, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَكَلَتِ النَّارُ بَعْضُهَا بَعْضًا. The hellfire ate itself. What did it do? It ate itself. And so it complained to its Lord. And then Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, He made for the hellfire two times to breathe. One time is when we burn in the fire, in the heat. And the second one is what? The cold. Are you with me, brothers? This is not a place you can tolerate. The fire is not a place you can enter. This fire that you see in this world is how many portions of the fire of the hellfire? 70, brothers. This is the volcano that recently erupted in Iceland. And aeroplanes couldn't go through the whole area. They were banned. They couldn't go through that whole... Are you with me, brothers? What do you think Jahannam is going to be? Are you with me, brothers? Jahannam is greater. So stay away from it. Protect yourself from it. تَصْلَى نَارًا حَامِيًا. They will enter into and burn in on an intensely hot fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He then says, تُسْقَى, they will be given to drink. تُسْقَى means what? They will be given to drink. مِنْ عَيْنٍ آنِيَةٍ, from a boiling spring. The word عَيْن in the Arabic language is a lafz which is mushtarak. It's a lafz, it's a term that takes many meanings. Ayn is a what? It's the eye. The spy is also called a what? The jasus is called a what? Ayn. Are you with me, brothers? The gold is called a what? Ayn. Arabs, they call this the spring that comes out of the earth. The water that gushes from the earth. What do they call it? Ayn. So it's a lafz which is mushtarak, meaning many terms, it's many meanings fall under it, the word ayn. Are you with me, brothers? Tusqa min aynin aniyah. Here it means what? The people of the hellfire, what will they be fed? They will be given to drink, they get thirsty. What do they become? They become, you're in fire, you're hot, you're burning, you're sweating. So what did they ask for? They said, could we drink? Allah says, tusqa, they will be given drink from a boiling, from a what? A boiling spring that comes from the hellfire. The fire, the heat that's coming, from the water, whatever's been given to them. Some of the scholars said it's more hotter than what they're in. Temperature of what they're going to drink is greater and more than the heat that they're already in. That's the punishment that is for them. Abdullah ibn Abbas and Al-Hasan al-Basri and Mujahid and Qatada all said that. They all said that. That they will be given a drink from a boiling, spring. Is it going to suffice them? Allah says, لَيْسَ لَهُمْ طَعَامٌ. That's for in terms of the fluid. Are you with me, brothers? In terms of the fluid, that's what they're going to drink. What about food? Because they're hungry. They're humans. They need to eat. Allah says, لَيْسَ لَهُمْ طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ ضَرِيعٍ. In terms of food, they will not be given food except from a poisonous, thorny plant that is within Jahannam. A tree that comes out from Jahannam is going to be given to them to eat. That's what they're going to be eating. Billahi alaykum, and it's poisonous. It's thorny, meaning it's got thorns inside it. Sharp thorns are coming out from it. That's the food that they're going to be told to eat. This ayah, some of the scholars, they said it seems. What did I say? It seems to be contradicting another ayah where Allah tabarak wa ta'ala, he said, وَلَا طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ غِسْلِينَ. And here what did Allah say? إِلَّا مِنْ ضَرِيعٍ. وَلَا طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ غِسْلِينَ. What does غِسْلِينَ mean? غِسْلِينَ means the discharge of wounds, the pus, and the discharge that comes from a wounded person. Allah saying in that ayah, وَلَا طَعَامٌ إِلَّا مِنْ غِسْلِينَ, which is the pus and the wound and the discharge that come from the person's body, that's the food that they're going to be eating. And here Allah is saying that the food that they're going to be eating is what? Huh? Dari'. And dari', what did I just say, is it's a poisonous, thorny plant that's in the hellfire. Sahih? So how do we reconcile between the two? Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti has a kitab called Daf'u Ihamil al-Dirab. This whole book, he wrote it for verses that seem to be contradicting one another. He reconciles between it. And he shows you that this is not a problem. Are we together, brothers? He said, rahimahullah ta'ala, that this is based on the levels of the people of the hellfire. Some of them, this is the food that's going to be served. Because the hellfire, what does it have? Huh? What's the levels in Arabic? Huh? Darajat is used for Jannah. Hellfire, what do we use? Darakat. Goes down, you don't go up. What do you do? So it's darakat. Don't use darajat for nar. That's for Jannah. Because darakat shows from low to high. Like a hellfire, where does it go? From worst to worst. So it's called darakat. So Muhammad al-Amin al-Shanqiti rahimahullah, he said, this is based on the darakat of the people, the levels. And each of them are provided different meals, different food, based on their class in hellfire. Here now there's another question. What do we, the atheists, who say, is it possible for a tree to grow in the hellfire? A plant to grow into the hellfire? Just to show you, brothers, they say a plant, where does it need water? How can it grow in the hellfire? Our argument as Muslims is, أن الله على كل شيء قدير. Allah has the ability of what? Everything. He's the same Lord who told us and we believe it without any doubt in our hearts. He's the one who said, Ya naru kuni bardan wa salaman ala Ibrahim. He took away the heat from the fire. For who? Nabilahi Ibrahim. We took it from him. He's the one who made the fire in the first place burn, and he's the one who can make it cold. Are we all together, brothers? But this argument of saying, how can a tree grow in the hellfire? The atheists today that are pushing it, it's not something new they came with. The shaitan that sent that revelation on these ones today was the same shaitan that sent the revelation on the early disbelievers. And Allah mentioned that in the Quran, أَذَلِكَ خَيْرٌ نُزُلًا أَمْ شَجَرَةُ الزَّقُّومِ. Allah mentioned it already in the Quran. Is it better accommodation for them? Jannah, is it better for you? Or is it better for you a hellfire which within it a tree comes out? And then Allah says, Inna ja'alnaha, we made the issues regarding this tree fitnata lil-zalimin. We made it a trial and a tribulation. It's a fitna. It tests your belief. Do you actually, would you believe this if you were told? Are you with me, brothers? And the believer, brothers, and this is something that's happening nowadays, which is skepticism, doubt everything, question everything. That today, to believe something, you're belittled. Are you with me, brothers? To actually have yaqeen, certainty. Like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, when he was told, they said to him, Abu Bakr, your friend, he claimed that he went from Mecca to Baytul Maqdis to the seven heavens all in one night. Abu Bakr. Hey, today, would you listen to that? Don't you see that it's crazy? Brothers, this is where Abu Bakr took the title As-Siddiq. Sah? Are you with me, brothers? Abu Bakr said, Wallahi, I believe him. Why don't I not believe him? I believed something greater than that from him. I believe that he told me, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that revelation comes to him from high above. And I took that from him. Going from Mecca to Baytul Maqdis, what is that? Are you with me, brothers? We, when we speak to the non-Muslims back in the UK, they will say to you, us, do you believe? And they'll bring a verse or here. Do you really believe this? And some Muslims, they get scared. They say, I don't know. They make you doubt your own deeds. Say, I believe it. What's the problem? Allah said it. I believe it. What's the problem? Are you with me, brothers? There was a story that was mentioned one time, and I'm going to conclude with that. A Muslim and a Hindu both said, today we're going to clarify, we're going to see which religion is haq, who's upon the truth. We're going to climb a very high place and we're going to jump from this place. And when we jump from it, each one of us is going to call on to their God. So the Hindu went up and he called on to Krishna or whatever he believes, and he jumped. He landed, nothing happened to him. He looked up at the Muslim, he said, hey, it's your turn. The Muslim looked around, he said, what happened? Are you with me, brothers? What did he do? He looked around and he said, what shall I do? He jumped, he called onto Allah and Krishna, same. Together, both of them. When he reached the land, the earth, what happened to him? He broke a leg. This is the truth. Our yaqeen, our certainty is all based on what? It's all based on what? It's very weak. ولذلك Allah تبارك وتعالى said about the believers, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا ثُمَّ لَمْ يَرْتَابُوا. صح? The believers are those who don't have rayb. They don't have shak. They don't have doubt in their hearts. Certainty. Yaqeen. I'll conclude there, inshallah ta'ala. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.